and that is to remember the very principles that unity is based on. That essentially it says that there's only one presence and one power, God the good, and that we are part of that. And not only we, but everybody who's involved with the voting process is involved with it. Everybody on the other side, everybody on our side, everybody who was denied the vote and everybody who failed to vote and everybody who did vote, we're all part of that one presence and one power. And the second power, the second truth that we hold to be true is that we are part of that, that we are part of that one presence. And it's actually a universal thing, that all human beings are part of that one presence and one power. And that should give us some solace when things appear to be dangerous or scary out there. That something is afoot in our, according to our philosophy, that says that this is working together for
good.
Part of the one presence and one power, and that one presence and one power is not evil itself, that it must be taking us in the right direction,
toward
a higher place of existence, a higher ground, a deeper understanding of our own true nature, a movement toward the unfolding of our natural gifts and our divine gifts. There is room in this world for everything, and we can remember, if we will, that our world is what we're really needing to take care of. And how are we taking care of our own business? Are we speaking the truth? Are we coming toward each other with compassion? Do we happen to try to understand what the other person's point of view and why they might have said or done what they did? Or are we just living in a world of fear and condemnation of other people? And hopefully in this time period, we will take a little breather and stop focusing so much on the differences and begin to reunite with each other through our hearts and minds as we realize that we are all in this together, and we always have been, whether we knew it or not. I know that part of the history of this country has been one in which a dominant group, people who look like me, tried to make it difficult for people who did not look like us to vote or to express their total humanity in many other ways. But we are beginning gradually over this time of several hundred years, gradually beginning to move toward a more perfect union. And it's in that vein that much of what happened in the early centuries of this country was that there would be high ideals spoken about, and they would be true for some people, but not always true for everybody. And we have been marching toward a greater sense of freedom since then, often quite slowly, sometimes not even taking all steps forward, but we have been zigging and zagging over the centuries. Today, I feel like with the Black Lives Matter movement, one of the things that's happening is that we, as a country, are beginning to wake up to the suffering of our fellow citizens and to recognize that we should be doing more to make it more fair and more equal.
We have tried to have a hierarchy of who's in charge and who's always near the bottom.
That's caused a lot of trouble in this country. And I think we're now really doing the slow wake up to what this is costing us. What is costing our friends and neighbors, and how we need to make a change. And that change is both personal and corporate, both just us making an internal change of more awareness and therefore perhaps acting with more facility and being more respectful of other people, but also in a society way. We've been asked to
do
that.
We all should have those freedoms.
We all should be able to express ourselves as fully as possible without fear of repercussions, that we should be able to create wealth. We should be able to grow our minds, to have safe places to live. These ideas are creeping and spreading and
infusing the whole of our population, and we are moving somewhat toward that. And as we do so, I think we create a much more perfect union. We are not limited by what happens on the outside world. That really a spiritual life is one in which we take ownership of our own experience and we mold it according to our own minds and our own hearts, not just letting the world dictate to us how we will feel, what we will think. And I declare this to be my thought for the day, to hold to a thought of hope and joy, to limit our suffering over things that we can have no direct control over, and to open ourselves to the real understanding that we are the authors of our lives. This is empowerment at its most basic level. You get to choose what you put in your own mind. You get to choose what you say, and you choose what you do. We choose our internal experience. We choose what we will experience in this world by how we hold our own self with dignity, with love, and with respect, with honesty, with giving the best of ourselves to every situation. We start to establish in ourselves a sense of honor and poise that we could not have if we are just willy-nilly blown by the wind. In addition to that, as we act with courage and with conviction in the direction we think it should go, even if you lose, even if this time you're not successful, you set up the conditions for being more likely to win next time. It's our job to live with strength, with hope, with love, with power, with grace, and to do it so that we tell ourselves and the world, this is how I think I should live. And in so doing, we set the conditions for our own success and the success of our next generation.